Overseas Filipino workers experience a lot of pain when they leave their families and adjust to new communities overseas. Perhaps that is why buying properties in their homeland is the first thing they do with their saving. It cements their ties to something they have known their entire life.
But they shouldn't go into real estate investing blind, with only their emotions and sentiments to guide them, since likely it is the most expensive asset they will ever buy in their entire life. A good strategy is very important.
So we have invited Carl D., President of Spectrum Investments, to help us talk about creating a strategy for 2018. Hello, Carl. Welcome back.
Hi, Salve and Quintin.
Hey, Carl,
how are you?
How are
you?
Good to see you.
Thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, so this is the start, essentially still the start of the year. And people are still hoping to find that great strategy,
right?
What to do with their properties if they're going to buy, especially for overseas Filipino workers.
Yes. So I think the most important thing before you buy a property is to analyze why. Mm-hmm. What is your reason why you want to buy the property? Is it because you want to buy something to build your own house for your family?
Own use, for example.
Own use, primary home. Or is it because you have your parents that you want to build something for them, no? So, or you want to build up your excess liquidity and reallocate it to be a passive income, mm-hmm. or income replacement for the future. So I think that's the first step, no, to know your reason, so mm-hmm. that you will, because each property will have different characteristics, mm-hmm. ideal for your why.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So essentially, when you're saying if this is for end use,
right.
Okay, what are the parameters then that okay for you if this is for end use? Those are different with a property that
investment.
You want to buy for investment.
To exaggerate, no, both ends of the spectrum. If you're buying for primary home, it should be important location in relation to your family, mm-hmm. location in relation to the school, location
which has an effect on price as well.
Yes, you're right. Location in relation to, let's say, your relatives and your source of income. But if it's an investment, mm-hmm. It's location in relation to your target renter, mm-hmm. location in relation to the business district. Mm-hmm. Oh, so that will be a big factor.
So you've changed criteria there depending on the use. Now, the question I have is, in terms of this real estate term called flight to quality,
right?
What is the defining criteria in terms of looking at the proper developers, the right kind of developers, to make sure that there's a better return on investment?
I think in analyzing developers, there are, track record is a big factor, mm-hmm. because you see how they've learned over the years, no? And I think the value of the owners is also a big factor. You try to analyze who are the owners and directors of this development company, mm-hmm. and what is their priority? Is their priority to make a quick buck, or mm-hmm. is their priority to make long-term quality developments?
So they're looking at everything from construction build to finishing quality down to
the character,
the kind of board and the kind of people.
Oh, yeah,
in
yeah,
it,
yeah. Because you kind of can predict what's the direction of the company depending on the owners.
And that's a lot of intellectual activity. Do you think that most Filipinos go through that kind of analysis?
I think at this point, maybe the more business savvy Filipinos would. But if you're, let's say, starting out, this is something that you can learn as you mm-hmm. as you go along.
But it's a good point, no?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's nice to look at both the track record side and at the
right.
same time the personnel side. I guess the question I have also in terms of getting the investment is, do you also look at the ease of which that you finance these investments? Because typically the case is an OFW will like the low pre-selling monthly ambag rates, right?
Right, right.
But then there's this big balloon payment at the end. Are you seeing developers become more savvy and more accessible in terms of the way they finance these projects?
That hasn't changed, Bakal.
Okay.
Is it still like that now?
Well, the easiest scheme is the no down payment scheme.
Yeah,
no?
Which is just not really true.
And then the monthly ka for,
yeah.
let's say, 2 years.
You're just spreading it out.
You're spreading
years.
Essentially,
out, no?
What they're saying is no down payment. You're actually just paying for the down payment,
yes.
every month for the next 2 years. Kunwari, very
5,000
pesos.
Exactly.
And then at the end of it, there's that balloon payment you're talking about.
The concept behind that is, if you loan from a bank, the bank needs 20% equity.
Mm-mm.
And then 80% they can loan to
but
you.
But most people don't have the equity.
So as a developer, they stretch out the 20%. Mm-hmm. So they will, let's say, sacrifice the first 2 years of getting small payments. But after 2 years, they get the bulk na from the bank. No?
Mm-hmm.
But personally, as an advice to OFWs and our friends overseas, it's better practice to put a down payment. I think it's better that you go into something knowing that you have 20% already.
Mm-hmm. And then, skin in the game.
Yeah, you have skin in the game, and you know na, I've been saving this equity and I don't have use for it I know how it feels to save up for this amount of money. Mm-hmm. And I've set it aside from my income for the past 2 years.
And so, on the flip side, the developers tend to give more discounts for people who actually put skin in the game.
Exactly, right? Which I want to ask you, because I know you've looked at all of these financing schemes.
Right,
no?
Right.
If you're using that kind of financing scheme, how much interest are you actually paying?
Okay, interest definitely from the bank.
For the down payment.
For the down payment.
Kasi it's tingi.
Right.
And then balloon payment.
Okay. Since I'm not a financial guy, I'm not too worried about the rates.
The IRR.
No? The way I see it is, let's say it's no interest for 4 years.
Mm-mm.
Vis-a-vis paying it in cash, but you get an 8% discount.
Mm-hmm.
Although on paper it's 0% and 8%, from a comfort point of view, iba yung you shell out the whole cash in one go. Eh.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very, very harder for most Filipinos.
Mm-hmm.
And then I want to also advise our friends, no, na although the bank can loan you 80%, my personal recommendation is 50%. If you can shell out 50% or half
already up front,
your success rate is higher.
Mm-hmm.
Kumbaga, the numbers will be more comfortable paying the bank.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a study na if you loan from the bank half, 50%, you have the 50% sweet spot. Meaning, your mortgage, your utang from the bank will be almost as close as your rent.
Mm-hmm.
So if you owe the bank 50,000, at the 50% equity, your rental will be around 50,000.
So it becomes a wash, basically.
It becomes a self-liquidating.
Especially if you're renting it out, right?
Yes, yes. So self-liquidating is a strategy, no? There are many strategies for property. One is you buy it in cash, then you start getting the income. But I like, personally, I like a more leveraged strategy wherein you use 50% of your cash and then you just let the bank pay for the half.
Mm-hmm.
And now the tenant will now pay for your loan.
So you're, essentially you're paying.
Yeah,
yeah, you run that for
because
10 years.
Because he's the one paying the
50%.
Yes. You know why this is an important strategy at this point? I see a lot of overseas Filipino workers who actually have the cash.
Yes.
And but they're saying, well, interest rates are so low nowadays, I can just actually borrow money and keep my cash.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That's not a good strategy.
So that will go, it will, you have to go into deep into your character. Am I the type who can save that money? Because for me, I'm a spender.
Mm-hmm.
If I have that money there on the table,
your temptation to spend it is there.
I'll be tempted to spend it.
Yeah.
So me, I use property installment as a four savings.
Yeah, that's
yeah. So now, the power of four savings very, very strong, because when you say you have a mortgage or you have an installment payment of 30,000. I mean, sometimes after 3 years, you paid it up, right? Mm-hmm. And you're wondering, oh, I made it.
Mm-hmm.
But before, you were so, you have
scared.
A difficulty saving 30,000 a
just
month.
Just wrapping your mind around the fact that you have to shell out that 30,
yeah.
40 a month.
So four savings is very powerful, especially psychologically.
Well, Carl, so you have four savings and you're coming out around the time for the balloon payment. How would you advise OFWs to get their paperwork ready so that they get that approval from the bank and avoid that default as many have undergone?
It's very simple. I have many experiences about loaning from the bank. No? Like there'll be people who will show me their credit card statement.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, this is my credit card bill. I have a high credit limit. No? But credit card statement is a liability. It shows debt, not really source of income.
Credit and debt, those are two different things.
So to make it simple, if you have a loan coming, the bank will give you, let's say, 3 million, 4 million.
Mm-hmm.
You just have to show the bank using documents that you're able to pay for the monthly. So that's the
income documents.
Yes, yes.
Tax, I think.
Or even proof of billing and all that, especially for OFWs who are used to paying their bills overseas.
Well, mostly proof of income.
Yeah.
Yeah, proof of income. So I would have clients show me, let's say, Carl, these are my assets.
Mm-hmm.
I have these cars, I have this property. And the worst case is, look, I have five other installments that I'm paying. So from the bank's point of view, that's not so good because you have to show me more income.
Yeah, you're exposed to other investments.
Yeah.
Is there a possibility that you get a better deal? Can you negotiate for a better deal?
Okay, I think from the bank's point of view, you can, I think. You know? So that's where the negotiating tactics come in. Yeah?
What's your number one negotiating?
Well, you know what, Salve? I'm not a good negotiator. Yeah, especially if you think from a bigger point of view. Sometimes those little numbers from a bigger point of view, it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, so Carl, let's assume you've already made the balloon payment. You're now an owner of this asset. I've seen this little monograph you put out. Can you take us through basically monetization strategies to make sure that your unit is rented and that you don't have any opportunity losses from not being able to rent it out?
Okay, so when you buy a property, let's say a condo. I'll use a condo because it's more accessible. Huh? Mm-hmm. So if your condo is not rented out, it's not making money. It's not monetizing.
Sleeping there.
There's a negative carry because you're also paying for dues. Right?
Yeah, there's negative carry. You know, you're paying for dues, but it's okay if that's your strategy and you want it there. You don't want other people to use it. You can pay for it. It's okay.
Becomes an emotional investment. Oh,
especially if you're coming home the next month.
Or if you're coming home the next month. So it's okay. You just have to tell yourself that this product is for my own use. I don't want other people to use it. Mm-hmm. I don't want to deal with the stress of having to worry about tenants. No? And then.
But let's assume you want to monetize.
You want to. So next strategy will be long term. Mm-hmm. Personally, I like long term, renting it out for 1 year, 2 years, three years, and so on. It makes it more passive, yung that strategy. So how do you make it successful? You make sure you know the target market of your property. If it's in a school zone, in an office zone, in a BPO zone. Mm-hmm. There are plenty of levels for market segments. You have the expats. Mm-hmm. I personally like the expat market.
The safest, no?
Yeah, you kind of can predict their budget. What do they like?
They're open to paying with having longer term contracts as well, right?
Longer term, or because when they come from a first world country, this is their residential budget.
So they know how to take care of your property as well.
Yeah, yeah.
You also find that, for example, you can ask for higher upfront security deposits if it's that segment of the market.
The higher segment?
Yes. The higher segments.
Personally, as a strategy, we just try to keep it fair. I firmly believe, I've seen people take advantage of expats. And sometimes expats, because they don't want any trouble, they just give in. Mm-hmm. But we value the experience of our expats. We have expats who stay with us for 8 years, 7 years, 6 years straight. Huh? Mm-hmm. No problem, no phone calls. It's because of the relationship we have. But you'll be surprised, Salve. I also have investments in the low market segment.
Really?
That's why I have both ends. Mm-hmm. I have the expats because they're very clear cut. You know where they are, you know where they're coming from, they know their budget.
Predictability. Yeah.
Predictability. And I have investment in the worker segment.
How did you make it
all
succeed?
The way to construction worker market?
How's it doing?
That's a big market. Uh-huh. Imagine this location building 5 towers. How many construction workers are there? Mm-hmm. Then I go to the owner of the construction company and say, hey, you want 12,000, 15? You can house 10 people. At the price of 1.3 per construction worker, the construction owner will take it.
How do you offset, though, the cost of administering essentially smaller cuts, smaller revenue streams, but with many people?
And what are the risks?
Hey, you know what? It may be smaller cuts, smaller revenue, but if you, let's say, have a building, a five-story building with, let's say, 30, 40 rooms, still a significant amount of money.
Economies of scale.
Yeah, but I guess the mindset there is both the expat and the lower market segment are good, but you want to spread your eggs. And I feel that... spreading your eggs, that's one. And then this is recession-proof, the lower market segment. Especially, I have properties targeting the BPO workers, which is really high in supply. Mm-hmm. And they have low demand. Mm-hmm. High in supply of workers.
Yeah, we have so many of them.
So many of them, but the supply of residential is low.
Yeah.
So that market segment is good.
How do you reach that market? Okay. Like, where do you find expats?
Oh, expats.
Maybe that's a question that our OFWs are probably asking.
It's mostly in business districts. They don't go outskirts. Mm-hmm. It's just in Makati or BGC.
How do you get in touch with them?
Right now, now is the best and easiest time for unit owners to have property, because before you have to put in a newspaper, classified ads, and it comes out every Sunday lang. Mm-hmm. And it's not even searchable. Now you have internet.
You have social media as well.
You have social media. You just put your picture of your unit using your phone. In 5 minutes, it's there.
No additional cost pa.
Yeah, no additional cost.
And it doesn't have to be exclusive either. You can go in multiple channels to promote property, right?
Yeah, I have owners who ask me, Carl, should I get a broker or not? Mm-mm. I tell them, you don't have to choose. You get a broker, and you do it on your own.
Whoever gets you the deal first, right?
It's okay.
Yeah.
If the broker comes in first with the client, then you ask yourself, okay, I'm giving out the broker one month's service fee. Mm-hmm. But if I don't rent it out on my own and delay it for 2 months, then
there's a trade-off there. Yeah,
yeah, a trade-off na rin eh. So yeah. I tell my clients, you just go all channels.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But now at this stage in our economy, which places would you recommend OFWs buy into? Assuming that they want to go the expat way or the low segment, if they're going to buy properties this year, what's a good strategy?
Okay, I guess the safest way is to go with the bigger developers. Okay. Because the bigger developers, they don't just build the tower. Mm-mm. They influence the whole community.
It's a township.
We call it the mixed-use development.
So may ecosystem na siya around.
May ecosystem. Yeah. There's retail that's driving it. There's dining. There's entertainment. So I think human beings, we tend to want to be in these kinds of neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. It's more convenient. There's groceries. So Mega Worlds, the Ayalas, they're all doing
this. Plus, you think in your studies that the take-up rates are much higher with these township types?
Definitely. Unless if you're targeting the school market, you have to be near the school zone.
Mm. Yeah. Does it still make sense to buy near Metro Manila, or do you want them to go to the provinces now or in other cities?
Oh, yeah. Not necessarily, because if you're aiming for a rental market, let's say rental market can go from the expats, the working class, no? Mm-hmm. The reason for renting is because their house is far. Mm-hmm. They don't want to travel. So they want to be near the business district. Mm-hmm. But they cannot afford to buy yet, so they'll just rent. That's your market. So you want to be close to the business district. Mm-hmm. Being far, let's say in the provinces or area where development is going, the strategy now will be maybe from a land. Mm-hmm. Capital appreciation strategy over time.
Uh-oh.
So land is also good, especially in the Philippine setting, I guess worldwide. No, if you look at land over the past 100 years, it's always good. Eh? You ask a Lola who bought a property.
There are dips like 97 crisis.
It eventually picks up.
Say, mm-hmm. So far for history, especially if you buy property, that is not highest of the high. There are two kinds of property. Highest high, you expect to go higher high, or low or fair, na there's a space in between for you to grow. So it's more safer to go here naman. You know, I have clients come to me and say, Carl, can we still buy this? It's so high. I tell them, you don't need to buy it at that price if you're uncomfortable.
There are so many choices. Ilo is an interesting place now.
Ilo is growing.
It's a new
secondary city, right?
What are other hot cities? Yeah. What are other hot cities now?
You know, let's make it closer to home. Pasig.
Not really. Yeah.
To all the audience
across
why
C5 Pasig? Or within the Ortigas Center?
Across C5. Huh. Because cities naturally grow. Mm-mm. Just like a balloon, when you press a balloon, it goes to the fringes. Yeah. Diba? Like, kunyari, Makati cannot grow to this side because it's Forbes and Dasma already, so it's growing to that side.
Yeah. Pasig it is lives
also,
and breathes.
Yes.
So you have some catalysts there, like the Grove already saying that actually that has a performance.
So you see that as a hot point.
Drive by C5. What used to be factories, industrial
warehouses,
land,
oh, yeah.
are now boarded up with logos of Mega World, Ayala Land, Rockwell. So development is going there.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting. Thank you, Carl.
All
Thank
right.
you so much
wow.
for your time.